Here we go. Painting with Menoth John is presented in Super Legitivision. Super Legitivision, the future of podcasting. It's .com.
Hello, I'm
Menoth John.
And I'd like to welcome you. First of all, let me take just a moment to thank you for allowing me back into your homes. If this is your first time with us, let me extend a personal invitation for you to drag out your
miniatures
and paint along with us each week. Let's go over to the canvas here and let's get started.
I believe, every day's a good day when you paint. I believe, it'll bring a lot of good thoughts to your heart. I believe, every day's a good day when you paint. I believe, it'll bring a lot of good thoughts to your heart. Let's build a happy little cloud. Let's build some happy little trees. There are no limits here. Start out by believing here. You can almost paint with anything. All you have to do is practice.
Well, hey everybody, we're back and better than ever. It's still lunchtime with Menoth John. Here we go. Here's the lunch cam. I'm having some hummus with red roasted peppers. It's delicious. A little bit of prosciutto. We got some kind of cheese here. Got carrots, apples. Man, loving it. So, of course, with me here as we break into the 12 o'clock hour of the Painting with Menoth John all-day extravaganza for juvenile diabetes. John, let's get an update on where are we with the GoFundMe for the juvenile diabetes.
Well, let's take a look at a mighty refresh here. We are still at 740.
740, amazing. Ladies and gentlemen, we have already surpassed John Con for total number of dollars that we are going to donate. So John Con was $747 that we donated to the Racine Food Bank, which was amazing. But we right now are above that because not only do we have that $740 that's here on the GoFundMe, but we're also going to donate the proceeds from the Patreon for this show. And so that's a little bit, that's more, which will put us up over the $747. So yay!
Yay! Hey.
But you know what? People with diabetes, they need even more. So if you've got an opportunity, get on out there. Give till it fucking hurts. We're eating the shit out of this because it's the noon hour, folks. What are you having for lunch, John? Oh! Salad cam. It's almost a crotch cam, but you put the salad right in front of your crotch. Good job.
Yep, I'm strategic like that.
Yep. Are you eating anything, Gonzo? Beer. Excellent.
Not yet.
All right.
Not yet.
Well, if it's Guinness, then Guinness counts as a meal, doesn't it?
But that was Sammy Adams.
Eat with a fork.
So, I'm having some cheese. I'm going to put some hummus on this cheese. See what happens.
You know what was funny? Is when she brought that and you put that plate down, the prosciutto and stuff and everything around it, it looked like it was hot dogs with a bun, a real short bun. I was like...
Nope. Okay. Oh, she brought me a water, too. That was very nice of her. So I'm going to have this water right now. I had the best girlfriend ever. All right, guys.
Aren't we supposed to have a surprise so big we don't know what it is?
Yeah, we didn't know what it was, so this is a surprise. There's nothing much going on. It's us eating lunch.
Oh. Surprise, eating lunch. Okay.
So.
Surprise lunch.
So what was supposed to happen was, this was supposed to be the point where we talk about movies. And as it turns out, we talked about movies with Lee and Neek earlier on. By the way, folks, if you've missed any of the Sunday morning extravaganza, we had Lee McAlpin and Neek of the Von. He's Dutch, and that's how you pronounce his last name. The from the Murder of Crows podcast. And if you want to hear some sweet movie talk as well as sweet Kator talk, that'll be up on the YouTubes. So you may have missed it, but you didn't really miss it. So, so
yeah,
good.
I feel like we need to find some more crappy movies and get Lee on again. and have another talk.
He seems karmically aligned, doesn't he?
Yeah, that might have to become a thing.
Mm-hmm. We can do that. All right, I gotta get my... You know, every hour, guys, we are saluting our patrons, because we love them. And if you were a patron, you submitted to the Brushhead Gallery, you would have the chance of winning a Fisherman's Guild Ball Army tonight after the Brushhead Gallery. Biggest Brushhead Gallery we've ever had, John, in Gonzo. 75 slides. That is 20 slides more than we've ever done before. Because it turns out, when you give shit away, people get motivated to send their stuff in. So,
awesome.
By the way, our Fisherman Guild, fully assembled, fully painted by Seth Watkins of Side Hustle Studios. So
he painted the shit out of that.
He painted the fuck out of it. You know, 9 out of 10 people can't paint the shit out of it the way he does. All right, so we're going to start honoring some more cronies. We have, for our first one, is Byron Lyles. Byron Lyles has been with us for a very long time. Thank you very much, Byron, for being such an awesome crony. We also want to recognize Nolan Gregory. Thank you very much, Nolan Gregory. You know, folks, we can't thank the cronies enough. They're the ones that keep the lights on. They're the ones that give us the ability to have these fancy graphics, like where we have things that are scrolling across the bottom. Boom. Super sweet. Kevin Brook. Love you, Kevin. Thank you very much for being such an amazing crony. We got some jack-off named John Spencer. He's a crony. And then we have Kev Bryant. Kev Bryant, we like to think of as the mercenary's apologist. He's got a podcast called Blood and Coin. You should listen to it if you like listening about non-factions. So there you go. Just going to tweak him a little bit there. So thanks, everybody. All the cronies, we love you. Hey, Ron.
Ron.
Big Weasel, what's up?
Oh, shit. Big Weasel's in the house. Now we can have a show.
Good.
We are loving it. I'm having apples and cheese and hummus. So, kicking ass and taking names. Oh, what up, Hairdo? Love ya. Richard Johnson, folks, in the house. That guy can paint That guy can paint the shit out of things.
Oh, my boy, Big Rich.
Mm-hmm. Love that guy. So it's lunchtime with Ben Off John right now. What's the strangest thing you've ever eaten, Gonzo? And don't name names.
Strangest thing?
Mm-hmm.
You know what? Ostrich.
Ostrich, okay. Tell us about ostrich.
Ostrich, you would think, you know, a bird. So it's like chicken. No, it's like steak. And it is super, super good. It's got to be, you know, medium to, you know, rare type thing.
Interesting.
But I was really surprised. I went to Disney one year and they were like, oh, here we go. Ostrich. Yeah, screw it. Bring it to me. And it was actually pretty good. It was pretty different. So, I'd say ostrich.
So, a bird you eat on the rare side.
Yes. Because because the meat is like a steak and not like a chicken.
Interesting. Interesting.
You also learn at lunchtime whipping out John.
Fuck yeah. John, what about you? What's the most unusual thing you've stuck in your mouth? This food.
Honestly, I don't think I've had anything I would really classify as really unusual.
Okay. That's fine.
I'm thinking about it. Like, I'm a pretty safe eater because my stomach is so hit or miss. The wrong thing could send me into a couple-day spin of
well, nobody wants
pain
that.
And sadness.
Nobody wants that. Nobody wants that.
No.
And ain't nobody got time for that. So I think the most unusual thing that I've eaten is boar. Wild boar. Wild boar is interesting. Wild boar is I had it and they had it in a fairly aggressive wine sauce. So I don't know if I really know what wild boar tastes like, but it was good. It was good. I've had octopus also, It's good. It's okay. It's like rubbery sushi.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I guess I've had calamari, but that doesn't seem very strange to me.
No, and yeah, I hear you. But I think boar is something that, you know, is a little bit more unusual.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
So I think that I would give boar... what?
Here or do.
Yeah. How about that one time you got desperate to drink a Coors Light? Dude, we're not talking about that time, are we? You and I made some promises about that time, and that's not going to happen again. So let's just move on. You know, it's like
that's
the line
funny
from...
because my stepfather used to just always buy Coors Light.
That shit's bad. It's just not good beer. I'm going to put my hummus over here so that I can... Oh, God. Now I got some room.
Turtle pot pie. Marshall, that sounds crazy.
It tastes like chicken. Chocolate-covered bugs. Sea urchin. Fuck sea urchin. No. No. No.
That's nothing.
Okay.
I used to... One of the lessons that I usually do is, you know, kids have to describe things. And you describe things by sight, sound, texture, taste, et cetera, et cetera. And so what I'll do is I'll bring different candies. And I'll blindfold them because I said, so we're not going to look at it. That way we can try to describe it with, you know, words. Instead of, you know, from the touching, the taste, the smell. And all the time, of course, I always bring sour stuff, you know, normal candy. And I always bring chocolate-covered ants. And I'm like, here's something. I mean, of course, I make sure nobody's allergic to anything. And they're like, this is chocolate. This is good. And how does it taste? And they'll describe it and stuff. I go, and it's an ant also. And then they spit it out. Or they gag and everything. I'm like, see, here's the problem. You loved it until you knew what it was.
Perceptions, baby. Perceptions.
We had this discussion at work on Friday. My coworker, who's a younger guy, can't eat any sort of meat that's pink. His idea of steak is well done.
Oh, so he's Trump. You work with Donald Trump.
He can't eat smoked chicken or anything like that. It's got, if it's pink, his mind just says it's time to throw up.
Interesting.
And I'm trying to convince him, like, look, dude, you got to try and get by that because A, smoked chicken is good, and B, steak, medium rare. You at the right place, you got to try that shit once.
Oh, yeah. Belinda is a huge fan of the rare steak, and I am as well. I love me some rare steak.
You just got to be careful.
Well, I mean...
I'm a medium guy.
So let's talk about E. coli for a second. The thing about E. coli is that E. coli is on the outside of meats. When you get into trouble is hamburgers, where they have the E. coli is been mixed in thoroughly with the steak, so you have to be very careful with that. With steaks, however, if you just take like a steak and put it on the grill, once you have seared the outside, you are safe. So you can go ahead and you can do the rare steak and not have a problem with it.
There you go.
Man, we're breaking off knowledge.
Yes, Big Weasel, ketchup on steak is probably sacrilegious.
Oh, my God. Ugh. I'm glad I didn't see that.
Yeah, when people come and bring me a steak, and they're like, oh, we're a steakhouse. And they bring me a steak, and they go, oh, would you like steak sauce? I'm like, you're not a steakhouse.
It's like, why? Does your meat suck?
Yeah. Do I need it? Because if I need it, I don't want steak.
Because I'm out.
Well, do that at the local Japanese grill. Everyone's always like, oh, I put my steak in the sauce. And I'm like, why? And they look at me strange. They're like, the steak doesn't need that.
Yeah.
And then, the chef who's standing right there gives me the approving nod.
Excellent.
Because it's true. If they make the steak right, you don't need sauce.
True statement of fact.
Sauce is for when you have the steak. Like, you when you're taking your leftovers and you have some steak bits left, if that happens... You mix the sauce in with that, because that way when you reheat it, well, then you need the sauce, because you're reheating steak, and it's not the best when reheated.
No. It's hard to reheat a steak and have it not suck ass.
Yeah, it's steak bits at that point, though, but yeah.
Yeah.
Doobie chicken.
So the thing that I struggle with Zenithal shading and using Zenithal, you know, the to go with the glazing and all that kind of stuff is that I have trouble with pooling, and I need to discuss this with Seth.
Because he's pretty good at this stuff.
I heard he's a reasonably talented painter. I need to talk to him about pooling and what do you do about it, because glazes are inherently watery, and I know you don't want to have pooling when you're doing Zenithal shading and stuff like that, and I don't want to fuck up what he did on my model because it's beautiful, and I feel like he can do things better than I can.
Don't fuck it up.
But on the other hand, you're never going to level up if you don't try and keep doing.
I know, right? I hate that.
And be honest, you're probably the perfect example because there's so much footage of it, of someone leveling up because you just keep doing.
I hear you, man. And I'll tell you what, one of the things I'm happiest about ever having done this show is that it has driven me to level up my skills in order to have something to continue to talk about on this fucking show.
Yeah.
You know, I don't think I would have ever done Glacier King if this show hadn't existed. I don't think I would have done half the stuff I've done if this show hadn't existed. I'm very thankful for this show. And I'm very, Gonzo and John, I'm very thankful for you guys as my sidekicks because you're awesome guys to work with, to be honest.
I appreciate that. I'm thankful too, because honestly, without this show and you guys, there's a fair chance I would have ejected from War Machine a bit ago.
Aw, that would have been a shame. I'm glad you're here, buddy. Well, I'm not sure about
you having to do things with other people and not do miniature stuff.
Thank you for bringing it back to ground level, Gonzo. Thank you for that. We almost had some feels there for a second.
You.
We almost had some feels there for a second, then that fucking ended. All right. God.
No, to get a good feels for you, I was in a really bad spot in my life, and that's when I sent you that thing, and I was like, dude, my Sundays are kind of boring. I need some help me get my mind off, and then you let me come on and then start it up, and it's like, I'm looking forward to Sunday.
Well, mm-hmm. I'll tell you, buddy, at the place you were in when all that took place, I would have been a terrible friend if I had denied you. So.
Well, if you would have said, just, you know, fuck off, Gonzo, you're a weirdo, I'd have been like, I love you too, but okay.
Nah. You're a weirdo, but you're our kind of weirdo. So we dig about you.
Oh, I have to leave. My lunch is ready.
Okay, get it
back.
Yep, see ya.
Hey, I'll take you on the trip, because I have a headset that can go places.
Okay. So we're gonna take a trip with Gonzo.
I'm walking down the hall.
Okay.
Ooh, I'm in the TV. There's my dogs.
Aw.
And then there's my iPad.
Okay.
And then here's my food. Shh, be real quiet, because there's my food.
Okay. I'm guessing.
Well, you don't want to escape?
I'm guessing.
It's hidden.
I was thinking that he might be getting carryout.
Mm. I actually was kind of hoping the dinner fairy would show up for dinner, but we'll see.
Man, I'll tell you what.
The dinner fairy is what I call one of the roomies' friends. She comes by and occasionally makes dinner. When she does, she'll usually make dinner for me too, but that's super awesome.
Open the door, and here I am. Look at that.
Excellent.
Magic skills.
Jaga Jaga is going to take a month of Sundays to paint, but when she's done, she's going to be pretty good.
I guess I better put these models away so I can...
Go ahead and eat, man. Lord knows John and I ate the shit out of our lunch on camera.
Absolutely.
I've got, looks like, chili flavored twisty Fritos and some sandwiches.
Sandwiches.
So how did you come upon all this bounty? Did you make that in the break?
No. Had someone else make it for me.
Well, that's nice. Like... All right. So we're getting there. Zenithal shading, if you glaze proper... I don't know if I'm glazing properly or not, but it seems like when you sketch it properly, where you put the colors, the white, you can really see the difference that it makes in the shades. I think.
Oh, absolutely.
Man. Okay, I need more beer. I gotta put this down for a second.
This is the song that never ends.
It just goes on and on, my friends. You know, I heard some people started singing it, not knowing what it is. And they'll continue singing it forever, just because. Come on, you don't know the song that never ends?
I don't know the song that never ends.
It just goes on and on, my friends.
That's what I've heard. From you right now. Hey, Belinda.
Hi, Belinda.
Hi, Belinda.
Yeah, it's right over here. Thanks, babes. She came over to get the hummus before it was ruined. My God, that was amazing. Good. Thank you, darling. John Spencer says hello. She says hello. I have so lucky I met her. Holy shit.
Absolutely.
I'm liking where even Jaga Jaga is going here today, because the I like the blue. This was something that that Seth told me. He gave me some colors to work with that would complement using the color wheel. And I need to get better at color wheel.
Yeah, color wheel is important.
Yep.
I bought one Friday just because of his recommendations.
Yeah. I need to get one that I can like have near me and just kind of spin the wheel and see how things line up.
Yeah, I also like, I don't need a color wheel. You know, I just go with the flow, but it still helps.
Yeah, it does.
Even if you are just, quote unquote, going with the flow.
Oh, God. Go with the flow, man. Go with the flow. We're just painting here, guys. You know, for those of you who are just watching here, we're assembling stuff. We're painting stuff. We're just having a leisurely afternoon, as friends will do. Doing our thing. Glad you're here with us, all 19 of you. Man, we've had a steady 19
wow,
or 20.
Mine says 25.
Yours says 25. Well, you know, it's different. It depends on where we're at.
So 19 are watching you, but 25 are watching me. That doesn't make sense to me.
Well, you know, Twitch.
That metric system.
Some of my viewers are metric, because I respect the metric system. Don't I?
We accept all walks of life. We do not judge.
We don't judge.
If you're metric, we're okay with that.
Do you know how much we judge? Not at all. Oh, I'm having so much fun painting this model. Building this.
I did talk to him about that, about Zerthal shading, because I was like, I want to get a mercenary model, because mercenaries don't care if they match my theme, you know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
And I was like, I got to find a mercenary model to do that. And I says, I want to do this. And he was like, well, when you get it, let me know. And I'll walk you through it. And I'm like, well, I'll fuck it up anyway, but okay.
I think you're too hard on yourself.
Your Kador looks beautiful, Gonzo.
Well, like I said, I did have one of our local guys paint all my troops, all that, the Winter Guard, because I just did not have the time.
No, I'm talking about your jacks, buddy.
Yeah, I'm going to spruce those up just a little bit more. But I think the whole theme, because when I put it down and I looked at it and it wasn't based, I was like, well, this looks very bland, and then just wasn't sitting with me. But then I put the snow and all that stuff, and I was like, yeah, there we go.
So actually, Gonzo, that brings me to a question that someone asked a couple weeks ago that I feel like we should answer at some point.
Yeah, let's do that.
Brian Skinner says, you want to help your friends get fully painted, so you do. But then they think that you're their permanent volunteer painting, then they get a colossal. How do you deal with it? I guess it's cheaper than buying a painting your own. He says, I guess what I'm asking, what's reasonable to ask? Bottle of whiskey? Sexual favors?
Yes.
One. I never expect someone to do something for me for free.
Absolutely not.
Even if someone says, hey, I'll paint that for free just because I want to paint that model, I give them something for it. The guy that did mine, I traded pretty much an entire Cephalex army for it. Because he said he wanted the Cephalex models, he wanted some Crick stuff. And I also gave him an entire Kickstarter of the Technics for Wrath of Kings. I just had it sitting here, nobody was playing it. I'm like, here, have this.
Oh, he's cutting out.
Yeah, we lost your audio there, Gonzo. I don't know if you can hear us, but we lost your audio completely. Not sure what's going on, but Gonzo, wave your hands if you can hear us. Okay, he can hear us, but we cannot hear you, Gonzo. Why don't you cut out and now that's better. I can hear you now.
Can you hear me now?
Yeah, I can hear you now.
Yep.
Just has that. So what did I leave off on?
John?
Technics.
Oh. Yeah, I guess I gave the guy the entire thing. You should always pay them something for what they did. If it's like a bottle of whiskey, but don't ever expect anybody to do anything for free for you.
Never.
Mm-mm. Well, that's the thing with good friends is you don't expect one way or the other, but they always take care of you. And if he's expecting for free, you need to definitely have a talk like, hey, you know, come on, man. What are we doing here?
Yep.
Yeah. Especially in your friends.
I mean, like, you know, Seth. I consider Seth a friend. I would never ask Seth to paint something for me for free. That's garbage. That's taking advantage of a good friend. And you can't do that.
Indeed.
So now what I'm doing here with this model is I'm coming back with a darker shade tone that from the bottom up to try to give a little bit more depth to the coloring.
Mm-hmm.
And I think, and what I'm using some color. So, Privateer puts out this thing called P3 formula. I got to put this on the website, John. It's what it does is it shows you the different kind of color groupings.
Mm-hmm.
And Seth showed this to me when he was at Casa John. And I want to share it with the group because what it does is it shows how the colors in the P3 line work together to produce lights and shades. And like right now, I'm using it's called Exile Blue along with the Meridian Blue and using it as a shade to show the color and the light on this Tetzel Worm.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, folks, this is, the Tetzel Worm is, I think, one of the most funnest, nice language, John, one of the most fun kind of models to make. I did Dolly and Scareth long time ago and had so much fun. That was the first model I think I ever really went after, the shading on it. And I don't know if you can see it on the camera, but you can see what just that little bit of Exile Blue does on the bottom of that hood. It makes such a big difference. Now what I'm gonna do here is I'm gonna continue to catch that Exile Blue along the bottom, and I might have a little bit too much color, to be honest. I think I might need to dilute that down a little bit, and we're gonna come along the bottom of this Tetzel Worm and give it just a little bit of love along in here and kind of wet blend it up a little bit. And then what I'm going to do is, because this is a dead Tetzel Worm, is I'm going to try and give some of the areas that are a little bit more a little bit more like the exposed dead flesh, I'm going to try and pale it out a little bit. But this is kind of how you use that P3 blending chart to your advantage when you're not going to be necessarily shading. I tend, where I'm using the Zenithal shading, I tend not to use a lot of washes, like Citadel washes. And the reason I do that is because the P3 paint guide, when you use it properly, when you use it as directed, and you use it as a glaze, you get these effects without having to use so many of those pre-done washes. And as you can see, I'm pretty thrilled with how this is turning out, to be honest. So be bold with this, folks, is my guidance. Is you got to be bold sometimes with some of this. And yeah, you may make some mistakes, and who cares? Who cares, really? Now,
that's
always...
why they make simple green and all.
Yeah. Yeah, boy, I'd hate to simple green this guy.
You can't be too afraid. The only models I'm ever afraid of are models I could not ever replace in any way, shape, or form.
Nope, I hear you. I'm going to take a little bit of moldy ochre now, and I'm going to reduce this to a wash, a glaze, perhaps, like you would say. I'm going to take a glaze of this, and then what I'm going to do is I'm going to come and I'm going to glaze the belly on Jaga Jaga.
That feeling when your drill bit just doesn't even drill into something.
Yeah, I hear you. All it does is spin location.
Well, like, it's getting a little bit in, but it should be... All right, we're done with that one, then. That's a dead drill bit. Keep it out so I can replace it. But other than that, it is no bueno. I'm trying to drill out the gun for the gun bore. Oh. So I don't drill out all my gun barrels, but I know El Marshall would probably cringe hearing that, but... there are certain ones that are big enough you pretty much have to drill them out if they don't have a good enough definition already. But we'll have to come back to that guy.
Here we go. Here's a quick thing we can discuss, because we didn't get to do it on the last podcast because it didn't come out. And Cosmic Scotty Potty kind of brought it up. The buff to battle engines.
Oh, super excited.
I am half excited and half disappointed.
Okay, talk to us.
Half excited, half scared.
I'm not scared. I'm disappointed. I'm half disappointed because they're only looking at a couple at first. And you're like, you can't be doing that. If you're going to do battle engines, the CID should be, we're looking at battle engines from A to Z, because you want them all to be in the same general power level. For the for the points, efficient power level for the points. So like the 12.1 with the who's that, the Grimkins. There's like this 12 points. It doesn't need to do the same thing as the Menoth one, but there needs to be some balance. And I know they'll say that they don't balance between factions, but that's the when I go on Max Finn, that's a big point of mine, is that maybe you need to a little bit.
Well,
because you can't have a 20 point model on one faction that is not even remotely the same power level as a 20-point model for the other faction.
We, at Adepticon, I talked to Hungerford, and we were talking about it, because the TEP, Convergence, is a super solid battle engine.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. So we're like, it's one of the best.
You buff that anymore, and there's going to be issues. And they said right now, what they're testing with that is just the points value.
Which is fine, absolutely, but I feel like the way they did the tease was probably, and I know it's not intentional, was just not them not thinking of how they should do the tease. Because they just listed two, and like, yeah, everyone's going to be excited, like, except that you're going to realize you're in a weird spot. You need to let everyone know that you're actually looking at all the battle engines, not just the two you listed.
Yeah, I mean, otherwise, I can see that.
Because the guys who are out there who want to be negative are going to go crazy. Oh, and don't give them any extra ammo. Just go like, hey, dudes, we're looking at all of them.
You know, I have kind of a distorted view, because my battle engine is great. The Protectorate battle engine is fucking amazing.
Yes.
And so I guess I understand why there would be some people who would... You know, they talked about the couple that got it, and the kind of buffs that they're talking about are dramatic. There could be some worrisome, but here's what I'm finding, and this is going to sound painfully positive for me, is that one of the things that I have noticed, that I'm becoming more and more satisfied with the changes that are happening, and I think that a lot of it has to do with our boy Pagani, and I've talked to Will, and I've talked to how he's being listened to at work. And it's good. He's being listened to. And that is only a good thing for the game, because when they lost David Carl, They lost someone who was very strategically strong at the game, who could break anything in sight and had the knowledge and the skills to do that. That showed in some things that were released. I think that Will's stamp is starting to show on this game. And I really think that the battle engine changes when we see them come out in the CID are going to be strong, well thought out, and maybe they don't make sense at first. But guys, if it doesn't make sense at first, the problem might be yours, not the problem with the CID. Thoughts?
No, that's fair. I just feel like it's... I really, really in my heart feel it's not a problem with what they're doing. It's a problem with how they're communicating what they're doing.
Interesting.
They're Expound. Trying to be... They're approaching it as if it's a game where everything's flowers and sunshine. And yeah, we're making it better. Yay! No, it's... This is doom and gloom. They unfortunately didn't handle Mark III the way they should have. There's a lot of negativity out there. There's people who are just waiting. I mean, the wolves are at the door. Hmm. They're waiting. Don't give them anything to howl about. Just go like, yeah, we're looking at all the battle engines. We're make them all better. Then if they say anything, they seem like they're absolutely, you know, douches. But if you say, we're looking at this one and this one, they're like, well, what about the rest of these that are already less powerful than those two? Everyone goes, grr, grr, grr. Or like Gonzo said, what about the transfinite emergence projector? That thing's already really good. What about the dead menite casket? That thing's already great.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's just going to be, once we get it all, we look through it and see, okay, yes, it is. But that's not really my big concern. With battle engines going to 30 to 34 wounds, which is incredible.
Oh, wait.
For that, which...
Be careful. Be careful. They said some are going to go to that many wounds.
Great. Okay, yes. Yes, I can say some. My thing is, what about Colossals? Because if you've got 30-some-odd wounds on this battle engine, and I'm only paying 12, 16, whatever it's going to be...
20 right now is the average, around the 20s.
Yeah.
Well, think about it. How much do you get a Kator or Jack? What's a destroyer cost or a juggernaut? What's a juggernaut cost?
12.
Yeah, 34 boxes, 12 points can boost, gets one focus. So, got to look at it from that standpoint. That was always my biggest standpoint. Is like, oh yeah, this siege crawler is super fun, but it is super fragile compared to Jacks that are cheaper, and the offensive potential. While it's there, you can't guarantee it like you can with a boost.
Yeah.
So I am happy that they're looking at them. They are probably part of the game that needs the most looking at as far as a model category.
Yeah.
But like you, I'm a little worried about where they're going with it. There's a tendency, I don't want to see them overcorrect. I don't want to see them undercorrect. Because they undercorrect, then it gets that doom cycle worse. And I don't need to hear that. I don't like these kind
of... I like that they're looking at it because I think they're one of the most cool models in the game that never gets used.
Yes.
Because they're super fragile. I mean, you can take them out almost no problem. So, yeah, I'm interested in it. I'm concerned that,
boy,
especially with 2017 come out, the way the scenarios are and stuff, it's a point sink.
Yeah, and making them too tough could be a problem because then you're like, look, I'm standing... you know, near this flag and in two different zones that you can't do anything about because I'm a battle engine and I'm tough to kill right now.
Correct.
So I think what we're talking about here, though, boys, is your mileage may vary because I look at my battle engine, the casket as you referred to it, and I really think that there are it's pretty survivable, but that's because I never go to war without mechanics that can fix it up, and that is because we lost John again, and that is because of the cutting mechanic that exists for that particular battle engine, whereas
correct.
I think more other armies don't necessarily go with survivability pieces that to war. because they don't have a really great reason to take them.
Yeah. I mean, and it's also looking at the Kador Battle Engine. That thing is legit by itself. It just typically doesn't bring back its points, or it can get taken out really easy. But by itself, jumping in and shooting and doing all the special rules on it, I'm just like, okay, let's see what they're going to do with it, because I'm interested. I will go with the Storm Strider.
I can't remember the last time I've seen one.
Well, it has to get tokens or power tokens or whatever it is to actually be really effective. How are they going to make it so it can good? Because it has to be hit for it to do that. So, yeah. And like I said, they just boosted the Scorn Battle Engine. That thing's stupid good right now. What are they going to do to it? I'm looking at it as a positive note that we got, that they're looking at some models and saying, hey, this is not as good as we want it to be, but we want you to field it. Here's what we're thinking.
Yeah, I hear you. I got to put some Thrall Flesh on this thing.
Some flesh. Some flesh.
I don't know where we lost John again, but
we lost him off the podcast.
Maryland internets to the win again. I may have to. I'm getting about close to needing a new thing for my wet palette. I'm about empty here. I've run out of space. I've mixed so many colors today.
Yeah, I need to start painting some more.
12:44.
I'm going to work on Strike Off 2, because he's super good.
There you go, buddy. Do that.
He makes my balls tingle.
Oh, nice. I like when your balls tingle.
It just makes me happy. There's a lot of...
So how's everybody out there enjoying the all-day broadcast? This is a Sunday. We've decided to give up a Sunday. I haven't seen any new donations. Let's go ahead and let's take a look here. I'll refresh it. We're at 740 before. We are at 790. We have had another donation. $50 from Richard Johnson out there from Hairdo Land. Thank you very, very much. I'm super excited. God, you know, Gonzo, I'm humbled and amazed at the generosity of the Brushheads. When Mr. Spencer and I kind of headed out on this path so many years ago, I never would have expected that we would have such a good audience.
Like I said, here's the thing about War Machine players and Horde players and this community. This is not a... This is, out of all the gaming communities I've been to, this one has been the best. It's more about the people, less about the game.
Yep. So thank you. Thank you, Richard. Thank you so much for your generosity. Super appreciate it. You know, we're going to kick juvenile diabetes right in the balls today. It's not even going to know what the hell hit it. Our power level's over 9,000. I don't even give a shit if your 9,000 is the same as our 9,000. It might be a metric 9,000, which is probably like 432. So we're super impressed you're here. Super impressed that you would spend your Sunday with us while we try to do a great thing for people who are struggling right now. You know, diabetes, no fucking joke.
Going back on, I think Scotty Potty wants to talk some Kador Tech.
Go for it.
That guy. With the yes.
He gave all. He has donated his ass off. So let's talk some Kador Tech.
Because we're talking about Strike Off 2. Yeah, I agree with you. Especially if the new Man of War theme list is any inclination or it has anything to do, it's going to be, you're like, damn. Because plus 3 armor on those guys with all the wounds
doesn't seem okay.
Yeah, it's going to be. Yeah, it's like another Meat Mountain or Fist of Halak.
Totally doesn't seem okay.
I hope it's just not extra points. I would really like to see them do something like advanced move or something that, or all their speed is increased by 1 point. That would be, because that's the big negative of them. But I mean, they have to be balancing issues, but still.
So, were you aware that I have Kador? I do have some Kador. When I was at for JonCon last year, Mr. John Medrano gave me some Kador. I have 3 units of shock troopers.
Yeah, buddy.
So you go, girl. I'm gonna have me some good times with them shock troopers.
Well, because what I'm looking at, and of course if it's a man of war, it gets on there. So I'm like, all right, so 3 units of shock troopers, or at least 2 with the UA, and then the solo, and now we got the new bad boy solo that has, you know, able to give out focus. Yeah.
Hey, John, you back with us?
Yep.
Okay. Good to have you back, buddy. Oh, and he went away.
And he's gone. Yeah, I mean, of the theme list, I hope they do a good Man of War theme list. I also would like a good Gracier theme list.
I think what kind of theme list?
The Graciers.
Oh, okay.
Their spellcaster things.
Like Grey Lords?
Or Grey Lords, yeah. Got it. I was like the Forge Seer. The new guy, he's a Grey Lord also.
God, that model is so amazing.
He's balls big, too.
Nice.
He's a huge model.
Poor John today. Poor John and his internets.
His internets are not good.
No, his internets are failing him hard today. I'm having such a ball painting this snake. Hey, John, you with us?
We'll see.
See how long it lasts.
Maybe. Yeah, this, like, Skype keeps dropping the call and not letting me jump back in. It's stupid.
No, we know it's not you, buddy. We know it's not you.
Well, it's part of my computer. That was a computer freezing and fun noises.
Noises.
What time is that? It's 12:50.
Yep.
We're kicking ass, guys.
Absolutely.
Jaga Jaga's coming along.
Yeah, just look, that worm's looking gold.
Yeah, I'm liking it. Put a little more highlights on it. Kind of went into the next level of highlights. Pretty happy with where that's coming from.
Super sweet.
Yeah, I got to put a little bit more. See if I got any more of that. There's that blue color I like. Okay, we got to put a little bit more water in there. Let's get a little bit more.
Using the Meridius blue?
Well, I started off with the Meridius blue, and then I highlighted up with Arcane. And I'm just kind of blending a little bit more of the Meridius blue down into the kind of the folds of the hood. Give it a little bit more depth.
I'm sorry.
So fucking childish. It's terrible.
You know what's funny? Is you're laughing now.
Yeah, I'm laughing. Oh, I'm not so grown up that I can't laugh at dick jokes.
Well, yeah, we'll go up for that, because we've got a whole section of that coming up, don't we?
Hell yeah. It's called the Beer Machine. So in case you didn't know, we're having Beer Machine is going to be dialing in the whole crew. Rich, JP, the other guy, Dan Vanderkoy. It's going to be super sweet.
The other guy.
Yeah, well, that's what he goes by, the other guy. So
I was going to let everyone in the chat room choose what I used my last 40mm base on, but of my available options, only one thing would actually fit on the way it's styled, so it ended up being a gun bore.
There you go.
I think I'm gonna leave his gun off till I get to drill out the barrel a little bit. After I got the real drill bits, go get the actual drill. It's crazy talk.
Shut up.
And yeah, here we do. I think John is the only one painting. Gonzo and I are just putting stuff together occasionally.
Nothing wrong with that.
I put together 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 17 models.
That's pretty impressive.
Awesome monkey model.
That's pretty impressive. Hey,
thumbs up for monkeys.
And elephants. As and he falls off the base.
Did you put together any pandas?
Yes, I did put together pandas. You want to see the pandas?
Oh, hell yeah.
All right, give me a second. Let me fix
this
base. Who don't
love a panda?
Panda incoming. Here we go. Just bear with me for a minute.
Da-dum-dum.
Ba-dum-bum. I see what you did there.
Those guys are cool. I like how they have two different models. You know, one's got the fists like that, the other one's got different fists.
Fists and different fists. We like that.
Well, yeah, it's different fists and different fists. One's got the sort of crescent things, the other one's got a different style of weapon on it. Don't make fun of my English language.
Somebody likes fisting, that's okay with us.
To the elbow and beyond, John. To the elbow and beyond.
Holy shit balls.
And I got my fox. What does the fox say? Get the fuck out
bark,
of here.
Bark, 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 bark. Bark, bark.
Oh. I almost forgot about that song.
Yeah, now we're referencing shitty songs. We've obviously hit our five, six. Who knows?
Oh, come on. That was a great comedy song. More funny because everyone took it seriously. Like, you don't... Did you look to see where these guys are doing normally? No? Okay. That's called humor.
Did get up my big sister up, Manted. If you're under the age of 18, look away now. She has nipple cups.
I want to paint them just to do that. All right.
Nipple
oh,
cup.
Jaga Jaga. You are so beautiful.
Pull up to the camera. Let's see a bigger picture of it.
Rich says by the time, at the current rate, there won't be any dick jokes left when they get on.
I know, right?
No. I can always tell the worst joke in the world.
No.
What are you going to do? Tell the aristocrats. Hey, Rich. Thanks for being watching the show. All right. So I'm going to put Jaga Jaga away again. I need to put time in between models that I'm working on. I'm gonna put Fiora's arm back on.
Are you gonna pin it this time?
Funny motherfucker.
No, he's not.
Fuck no. Ain't nobody got time for that.
I'm drinking.
Wow.
I am drinking the wonder that is Smirnoff Ice because I like it.
I'm drinking Manhattan from Southern Tier because Rich from Beer Machine gave it to me. So
that dude?
Yeah, that guy. So I've got this arm on here, and I'm going to have to do a little bit of repainting, but I think it's going to stay good this time.
So she's no longer mostly armless?
No, she's not armless at all now. Man. So during, I think, RPG talk, I think I'm going to probably go and OSL this bitch.
You got to stay for the first thing, though.
Okay, I will. Hmm. I will. So that's a tease.
Did you lose your bit? Did you lose your bit?
No, it's here. It's right here. It's just still in the model.
Yeah. Lose it in the model.
So nobody knows why Fiora happens to be grabbing the tailpipe, the exhaust pipe from her horse, let alone why there's an exhaust pipe on the horse. But I think it's going to get more stability to the model. In fact, we're going to glue her hand to the tailpipe. Boop. Right. There we go. Now that hand is not going anywhere.
Anywhere?
Anywhere.
That wasn't that hard to get out. Thank you. Anyone?
Like this guy. This guy's got two balls. I mean, spiky balls.
I am so happy with the things I've gotten painted so far on this show.
Well, I'm currently assembling a bog trog mist speaker because that's actually pretty good.
Oh, yeah. Two of them is even better.
So
I only need one right now because, but I could see how two could be good, especially if you're playing bog trogs. And one of my future endeavors is to make bog trog ambushers great again.
They've always been great. I don't care what anybody tells you.
So there's a problem with minion models, is that they're minions. Mm-hmm. And unlike mercenary models where they've gotten over the whole they can take them to their factions, there's still some that are not as good as they should be because they can be taken to their factions. And I think bog trog ambushers are some of them because they're okay, but they're just not great.
Okay, so let's talk about their stats for a second, if you don't mind, John.
Oh, by all means. By all means.
So, and if you would look them up, I'd appreciate it. I'm the worst fucking host ever. Let's talk about them. I'm gonna raise a subject, and you're going to figure out how I'm going to talk about them.
All right, so they are speed 5. I know that without bringing them up, because why would they be speed 6? That's not necessary. Speed 5, strength 6, mat 6, rat 3. Rat doesn't matter. 12-14. Command 7.
Yep, shitty.
Yep, they have advanced deploy and ambush, so it's 6.5 thousand.
So they have ambush.
Amphibious. They also have combined melee and Pathfinder.
So Pathfinder, speed 5, so they charge 8 with 2-inch reach.
Yep.
So 10-inch threat off the side of the board.
13, because you deploy within 3.
Okay, so 13 inches. So I've got a unit I get to ambush with, and that's called Daughters of the Flame. Mm-hmm. Daughters of the Flame have half-inch reach. They're speed 7.
Speed 7.
Yep. And they go 13 inches, right?
13 and a half.
Yep. Not that different. And I will tell you that that ambushing Daughters of the Flame is some hot frickin' garbage. That is some shit right there.
Yeah, but their defensive stats are not unfortunate. So everyone considers Stormblades to be victim stats at 12-15.
They are.
These guys are 12-14.
Right, but Stormblades don't get to ambush.
So, well, let's see. They also have Pound Strength 11, which is okay. And they have Pull, which is a completely, I'm not going to say worthless, but pretty much it's a worthless rule on them.
No, it's worthless.
You get to pull them directly towards, which, if you manage to walk into stuff, is good. Or if you manage to charge and get a bunch of guys together, and maybe you kill the first guy, so you pull the other guy closer, so a couple other guys get some attacks. That's fine. And it's still only equal or smaller base, so it's not a good rule.
No, it's terrible.
And the full unit is 16 points.
So that's 10 man?
10 man, 16.
Yeah, they're overcosted. I apologize. They're overcosted.
Yeah, but, and I can say they're bad because you can see they've got some use.
Yeah.
But they need a couple more things to make them decent. You know, like, I would start with making them def 13. I don't think that'd be crazy at all. And then just look at their stuff, or you can just make them cheaper.
They need to be cheaper, I think, more than anything else.
They're not bad. They're just not good either. And the problem with minions ones is I feel like, and this is going to be slightly negative, and I apologize. I'll try and keep it from being just railing on thing. I think when PP did Mark III, there are certain models you can absolutely tell they gave the love to. They're like, we want to make this model right. Let's make this right. And there's certain models you're like, that could be the exemplar of an X-point model. And then they got the minions, and aside from brigands and gators who are on the opposite sides of things, they're like, they took those, one went way down, one went way up. Everything else is sort of like, let's just make them work in this edition, and then said, fuck it, I'm gone. and they didn't give them the proper time to looking at them.
Well, I mean, I think it's, I don't think it's overly negative, John, to say that, to be honest, Mark III was not as well tested as they said it was, or not as well tested as we all wished it had been. I don't think that's, I don't think that's a negative.
It was.
I don't think that's negative at all. Hey,
so
by the way, we've had
work.
By the way, we had two more donations.
What?
We are at 860. We're at 865 right now. Chris Suri, I hear he's pretty good at fucking painting.
Yeah.
He gave us $50, and Fred Golightly, $25, which is amazing. Thank you so much, Fred. Thank you so much, Chris. Guys, I don't know where to start with the generosity of the people who watch this show. Thank you so very much for being a part of our show today. To think, John, that we are on the precipice of giving $1,000 as a podcast to juvenile, and by precipice, I mean we're going to give $1,000 to juvenile diabetes as we sit right now, because we're going to donate a full episode's worth of the Patreon to this
Patreon
as well.
Yep.
It's absolutely amazing. So $1,000, folks, that is amazing. And if we could get $1,000 to the what you got there, buddy?
Just raising my glass for a run. Yeah. I know it's coming.
To get $1,000 for the GoFundMe, and then us throw that extra $150 from the Patreon. Absolutely amazing. So here's to all of you who have given. And if you haven't given, think about it. If you can give $5, if you can give $1, it's still another dollar that juvenile diabetes has not gotten. Hey, Ron.
Ron.
I am so humbled by the people that watch our show. So humbled.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so many shows don't have the kind of fans that we have. And thank you. Thank you so much from the bottom of our hearts. You know, this one, when I was thinking about what we should do as far as a charity to support, my heart went out to Gonzo and to PG Kim. And how can we honor her memory as a part of this show? And thank you. Thank all of you for your incredible generosity. Incredible generosity.
All of you.
Yep.
Here.
Like I said.
I hope I can paint this siege crawler as good as I've painted this base.
I have confidence.
I like this base. Holy shit, that turned out better than I expected it to. So coming up in a future Painting with Men Off Johns is this son of a bitch. Yeah. That's an extreme Carnivian.
What? Because reasons.
Yep. This
oh,
was...
Oh, shit, John.
What?
Oh, when you get done with that, it's time for Gonzo to talk about role-playing games.
Oh, shit.
It?
Oh, fuck. It's
what?
1 o'clock.
Is it my time?
Oh, it's 1 o'clock. Okay, ladies and gentlemen, we like to break every hour because we want to snip this into bite-sized pieces you can stick in your mouth and roll around with your tongue. All right, so that wasn't at all disgusting. So we're going to be back in like a minute. So thank you so much for being a part of Painting with Men Off, John. We are going to be right back with more PWMJ all fucking day. We'll be right back.